So I'm really happy to bring you Madeline Henry today. She's an amazing author, amazing human being, and thanks so much for being with me. And we're on Inspire Living, which is for inspiring people. So I think your story and your book's really going to do that.
Great. It's such a treat to talk with you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So tell me a little bit about your story. How you've been to Yale and all that, but before that, what were you doing?
Sure. So before Yale, I was born in New York City. I grew up just outside New York City in Westchester, New York. Mm-hmm. And then I went to boarding school at Exeter. And then I went to Yale. And after Yale, I did investment banking at Goldman Sachs. And so it was a pretty conventional overachiever track that I was on. And then I found the world of yoga and put the two together in my new novel. So,
yeah. So Breathe In, Cash Out is your new novel that's coming out. What was your first experience with yoga?
Well, it's interesting because I know that you come to yoga from a very traditional background, and I come to yoga, my entry point was Instagram. So what happened was after I left banking, I went into investing, and with my free time, I started to work out more. And what's interesting is that in New York City, yoga is marketed as a workout. And so I came to it with this very Western, modern perspective of, oh, I'm going to go work out and do yoga. And so that was my entry point. And as I started browsing on Instagram, I found this network of major yogi Instagrammers. Mm-hmm. And so these are mostly women who post pictures of themselves in yoga poses, and they all follow each other. They comment on each other's posts. They appear in each other's posts. And as a caption, they will often post wisdom from a spiritual guru or a yogi. And so I was working out, surfing Instagram, and that was how I found yoga, which is very modern, very Western. And so what happened was I saw these beautiful poses, and they were very difficult. For instance, someone in a handstand putting their feet on their head, so handstand scorpion, or a standing split where you are doing a split that's perpendicular to the ground. Your toe is pointed to the sky. And I saw these beautiful women doing these incredible poses, and I thought, I want to be able to do that. And so then I started practicing on my own, and I was reading these captions with spiritual wisdom. And the more I did it, the more I left this, it's a workout mindset, and it became something different and meaningful to me. So that is how I got into it.
Interesting. So yeah. Instagram does have a place with yoga.
Yeah. And I mean, different people can take different things from the same picture. But I just really wanted to be able to do these poses. And the more I practiced, I found the more my mind stopped. And so Patanjali, one of his sutras is that yoga is the cessation of the mind. And I found that with very deep practice in very deep poses. Where I just stopped thinking. And that was something very different from the finance background that I had come from, where you're rewarded for activity, you're rewarded for mania, you're rewarded for producing things, even if they don't have value. And I found something where being still and literally holding the same position for much longer than you hold anything normally is very peaceful.
So it became like a focus practice.
Exactly. And it was really an oasis. And I've listened to, I heard you speak once about the difference between the heart and the head. And to me, the finance is very head energy. It's very selfish, egotistical, angry. And yoga is very heart energy. So it's very cool. It's very calm. It's very collected. And so I've had a very physically focused practice. And that's where I really found the yoga energy in my life while I was still working in finance.
Yeah. Well, in a way, you've kind of been blessed to have, at a very young age, both of those things so you could juxtapose them and look at them and see what both of them offer. You know?
That's true. That's true. I agree with that.
Yeah. So your book starts with a quote based on Money and Wall Street, and then a quote from Gandhi. Is that very much what the book is about?
Exactly. So the opening quote, it juxtaposes something from Gandhi, which is talking about love and friendship, and that's a very heart quote. And then it's juxtaposed with a quote from Michael Lewis's Liar's Poker, which has the F word maybe 10 times in one sentence, and that's a very head quote. Yeah. And at the center of the book is the juxtaposition of the yoga world and the finance world. So the main character, her name is Allegra, and she, like me, was on the overachiever track. So she went to Princeton and then a fictional investment bank where she was making six figures at age 23. So she decides to go in the completely opposite direction into yoga. Mm. So banking, you can say it values money, external power, and prestige. And yoga, you can say it values humility and inner power. And so she really takes a right turn and tries to reconcile these two worlds before her contract expires. And so that's what the book is about. And I hope that that's embodied in the opening two quotes.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, you definitely get people's attention when you quote something about money and then Gandhi.
Yeah, that's for sure.
It kind of tells you what you're in for.
Yeah. It also, the book involves a fair bit of Instagram. And I think that the cultural moment that that's tapping into is people who are discontent at their office jobs and are developing these escapist fantasies to help them cope with lives that they don't love. And some of these fantasies are coming from Instagram. So you see people who are lifestyle bloggers, professional travelers, yoga Instagrammers, and people who don't love what they're doing, something doesn't feel right, they turn to Instagram and they start to imagine, oh, what if I quit my job and ... And so that is also expressed in the book through Allegra's journey.
So Allegra's journey, is that really your journey?
No.
Okay.
It's funny because I share so much of my background with Allegra, I have friends who think it's a memoir, but what's interesting is that I didn't find yoga until after I'd really left banking because I didn't have any free time in banking. So I never had to reconcile the two worlds at once like Allegra does. So she's in for it. I had it a bit easier.
So you're living through Allegra a little bit.
yeah, exactly.
So when you say that, years ago, I used to be in the fashion business. And when I did kind of what you did, I left at the peak of a career. And people were saying to me, "How are you stupid? You know, you're losing so much money. How are you going to make 50 grand in a day?"
Right.
And inside I was feeling, yeah, but this train ride is over for me. The train's continuing, but I'm just not going to be on it because of that feeling I have, and I just can't deny it, so I've got to go with it. Is that the sort of thing that happened to you?
Yeah, that's really interesting. So I feel like when you're young, the conventional metric for success is grades in school, and then when you become an adult, that metric becomes money. And people who don't know what they call success just turn to the conventional metric, like straight A student, making a lot of money, that person is successful. And I think that what it takes is it takes time alone to figure out what do I need, what makes me successful in my mind. Once you have that, it's very easy to leave. And for me, my metric is health and mobility. And I just could not find that in banking, where you're in a chair 20 hours a day, you get up to pick up your delivery order, and that's your exercise, erratic schedules, and that's not success in my definition. And I think that maybe when you found your own definition of success, it was much easier for you to pursue that. So.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't have an education in anything at sort of 32, 33. I had to get re-educated and I didn't know what I wanted to do. You had this feeling that, you know, you have a calling and you've got to go do it. And at the end of the book, I like the way the pretzel guy said, he's disappointed in you.
Yeah, spoiler.
No, don't worry. This will come out just when the book's coming out.
Yeah. Well, I like to think that this head and heart duality has meant so much for me in my life. So just returning to that, I feel like when you're in the head, you're all about building protection for yourself. So when you're living in the head and you're working in finance, you're all about this wall of money to protect you from the world, and even sometimes to protect you from other people. And that's your life. But when you return to the heart, you do become more vulnerable. So you choose this new career path that exposes you to failure potentially. And you don't have, you know, a giant, reliable salary. You don't have that reliable income anymore. But if you're staying true to what you feel is right, that can be another form of power and stability. So, you know, I used to be in a room where people were playing a game of how long they needed to work to buy a $20 million townhouse in Soho. And that's a very head game. That's a very protected game. But, you know, I'm now a full-time novelist, and that's a heart game. So it's a little different.
Yeah. Well, you can still bring some of your experience from that world, because finance is in everything. It's in the yoga world. It's in the spiritual world. You know, people got to pay their rent and pay their mortgages and everything. So it's still there somewhat, although maybe the focus isn't that. But what I find is because we're talking about this novel and the position it takes, is that I find more and more money issues come into the spiritual and yoga world because people can't, for example, support themselves or be sustainable. So suddenly the heart and the head are having a little battle together of what's right and what's wrong.
So I have my own yoga Instagram where I post pictures of myself in yoga poses and captions. And so I do a lot of reading of quotations that are steeped in yoga philosophy. And one of them is follow your heart, but take your head with you. And I really believe that it's not the heart or the head, that there is a balance that you have to achieve to feed yourself. So it's all about finding the proportions that work for you. And I was way too head at the start of my life, and now I'm adjusting. So.
Well, I kind of see you also spearheading and helping a lot of people in the industry to know how to survive and how to thrive and still be able to do what they love and find that balance, because you've had to go through it yourself.
Absolutely. And so what's funny is people who come to me, and one of the questions I get asked is, how do I figure out what I really want to do? And something that I say back is, well, what do you already do? Because if you love it, you're probably already doing it a little bit in your life. And so for me, I was always a writer. So I wrote in college. I did a tutorial with a professor where I wrote a novel each semester. And this was a one-on-one tutorial. And so what do I love? Something I love is writing. And I've always been doing that. So.
Yeah. You were part of the Yale Comedy Club.
Exactly. For sure. And what's funny is I wrote science fiction novels in college, and I view that now in retrospect as earlier in my development, I was more plot focused and much more, I over-intellectualized things. And as I develop, I try and write more character development, more emotional situations, and that's a more heart existence. So
you're a comedian as well somehow.
Yeah. I like to think so.
No, that comes off in the book. You put in, what I like about the book is it really gives a realistic idea of what the yoga world is about too, because the yoga world has become sort of commercial. It's had, used to be a little bit more exclusive, sort of like when I was in the fashion business, we felt like a very small family. It was very small. And then suddenly now everything's, you know, commercial. So I think the yoga world has become that for good and for worse in some ways, because everything that becomes commercial has the upside and the downside, right?
Yeah, and I think it's all about balance, because I used to, when I was looking at these yoga Instagrammers, see them model clothing brands, and something about that didn't feel right. But the older I get, the more forgiving I am that they're tagging brands and that they're working with companies and making it a commercial practice, because it is a job too. So I'm more forgiving as an adult of that.
It's become a work. You know, some people say we have a job or we have work. But in the end, we still have to, you know, be financially sustainable to do the things we want, unless we go and live in India and stay in an ashram. And,
exactly. You know. But it's also about, I like to think about where my people are. And so the people I love are in New York City. And that means that I have to work a certain amount to be with the people I love. And I know someone who tries to separate what sustains him from what fulfills him. So sustaining meaning his job, and fulfilling meaning poetry. And it's all about the balance that works for you, and just owning your balance with integrity.
I've had to go through it. We're all going through many, many different ups and downs, struggles and things which are personal to us. But I find that the struggle between money and spirituality sort of becomes the most wide struggle, because as more you get drawn into the spiritual world and you do more of that, you become more detached from money and you don't think about it. And then, of course, it creeps up on you. And I've heard that story many times.
I agree. I think as long as you are upfront with your balance in your own formula, then I respect that. But if you're hiding, if you're lying, if you're deceiving, then that's when your balance is off kilter.
Yeah. One of the things, Allegra Cobb, right, in the book.
Yeah,
she wins the yoga competition. I found that the first time I ever heard about a yoga competition, I was thinking, wow, that's competitive. But yoga's not supposed to be competitive. What's going on here?
I know.
Did you put that in the book to show the competitiveness of yoga or her?
Well, first of all, I found it fascinating. So I feature in the book a fictional yoga competition, but there is a real yoga competition.
Many of them.
And it's incredibly impressive. It's basically gymnastics, but they are asana, so it is yoga. And something that I hear a lot is, you're so good at yoga. And to me, that always feels weird, because the more you practice, the less about being good at it is. It's just about returning to the practice. And if you're trying to grade someone on their yoga, that's really divorced from the roots of it. So what I find really fun is I go to a yoga class at Equinox about once a week, which is a very expensive gym. And the people I find in this yoga class are some of the most competitive people I have ever been in a room with. And whose handstand is the best, and it's who can do the deepest split, and it's who can hold their leg up the highest. And I start getting stressed out in this class. So I went there with my boyfriend once, and he really only knew me at that point through my yoga Instagram. And he was expecting me to be this kind of gymnast, I guess, in the class. But I think that when you really honor the spirit of yoga, you're not going to go beyond your limit on that day. And it's about bringing heart into the room. And it's not about, showing off your muscles and holding a handstand for as long as you can. But yes, there are yoga competitions.
Yeah. I was surprised when I first heard about them. And then I saw a couple of clips online and I thought, oh, this is gymnastics, but they call it yoga.
Exactly.
Because the nature of yoga is to be united and to break down the barriers and to take away competitiveness, not enhance it.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I mean, one of the conversations always comes up with people in the yoga world and spiritual world is it good what social media does, and is it good what how we're commercializing yoga and everything basically, and do we lose the essence of it, or is it just up to that person to keep the essence of it and just be inspired by everything everybody's doing?
I mean, Instagram is not reality. I know everything online is enhanced. So I can only speak from my experience what social media and yoga have done for me. And it's been very positive. I never would have found yoga without social media. I never would have had the education of that spirituality, even though it was in Instagram captions. That has still been incredibly meaningful for me in idea transmission. So the ideas about quieting the mind and living from the heart and being generous, I got all of that from social media. And so, yes, photographs are enhanced. Yes, it it can make yoga more superficial, but it's linked to something real, and it really did change my life in a positive way.
That's great. No, that's good to hear. It's good because there's so much cynicism about all of these things. Some people hate it. Some people, everybody still does it, but a lot of people are not for it and they think it's doing more damage. And I agree. I think it's an individual choice of how much you get involved with it and how much of it you do, because in the end, you're the one who's doing. Everybody else is just presenting whatever else they're doing. You're the one reacting to it.
So, for sure.
One of your chapters, I think it opens up with, who knows what the F bankers do anyway, which I thought was interesting. What do bankers do?
Okay, so I did not progress very far up the hierarchy, so I can speak to the junior banker experience. Mm-hmm. What a banker does is they put together presentation materials that senior bankers bring to meetings with companies, and they usually are related to a deal that company could do. So buy a company, sell a company. And that presentation is what I worked on as an analyst. And they can come at any time. You never know when you're going to get a new presentation. You never know how long it's going to take. But that is the job. And so putting the presentation together, you are creating charts, you are building financial models of companies, and then outputting those results in pictures and putting it all together in a nice, beautiful book.
Nice. So how long did it take you? You weren't in it long, but you were in it long enough to see everything and feel everything. How long did it take you to sort of recover in terms of peacefulness and get yourself more tranquil in life? From when you left your job to when you started to do what you love?
Yeah. What's funny is I don't feel like I'm fully recovered yet. I heard that you teach best what you need to learn, and I still am learning. So although some people come to me as a teacher, I feel like I'm not a teacher, I am a learner. So I think that I did start to transition away from finance into more of a yogi life while I was still working there, which did not help me at those companies. So it's been maybe a few years of taking it to heart so far.
Yeah, if you're in the money world and you start the yoga, or maybe I should ask, do you think now looking back at it, there's a place for both of them in money world and the yoga world, or for somebody to work in one and work in the other? Can there be a balance?
Yeah, I definitely think so. It just was not for my temperament. So I just couldn't handle the completely unpredictable schedule, the sedentary lifestyle. I found a lack of meaning in putting together the presentations personally. That's not for everyone. But for people, I know people, they're my friends, who are bulletproof to that. For some reason, it just doesn't affect them. They weren't as sensitive to it as I was. And I feel like everyone's at a different place on a spectrum of sensitivity. And I feel like my physical existence, I'm very highly sensitive to that and to my body and what my body's telling me. Other people, less so. So they can find a more finance heavy balance in their life. I just couldn't do that because it was so painful.
Yeah. So I guess that's what meaning to be true to yourself means, feeding yourself what makes you evolve rather than keeping yourself in a place because it's just feeding you financially.
So true.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, your book is fascinating. I think it's a great book. And I think a lot of people are going to find it a nice read. And, you know, it's not about your life, but it definitely gives you an insight into what a banker will go through and what they're going through now. And everybody needs, you know, peace in their life. So hopefully Allegra has found it.
Great. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
So your book is called Breathing Cash Out, and it comes out July.
Exactly. Yes.
Beautiful. Okay. I wish you all the best, and thanks so much for talking to me. Namaste.
Thank you so much. Thank you.